So yes, hello guys. So welcome to today's lecture. Now, today's lecture we're going to be talking about foodborne illnesses. Now foodborne illness, आज की डेट में it is coming to be a very very important topic. आज की डेट में नहीं, काफ़ी सालों से जो है इस सब्जेक्ट को जो है काफ़ी इम्पोर्टेंस और अहमियत मिली है. Now we are going to be dealing this, trying to understand basics of foodborne illnesses. यहाँ पे आज शायद हम will be discussing more on microbiological illnesses, diseases that are caused by microorganisms, diseases, foodborne diseases that are caused by protozoans, by viruses and by helminths. Helminths यानी कि worms. So ये topic को समझना इसलिए important है because we as consumers, when we go to the market, when we consume things, when you consume food stuff that is available in the market, we need to be clear and we need to be what you call absolutely aware and cautious about what we eat and what is the risk involved in consuming what we eat. So it's a fundamentally essential subject. It's not just for students who are into food processing or dairy technology or somebody who is into botany or zoology. In fact, this is a subject that is important and relevant to all consumers, if you ask me. And it always helps. Okay, if consumers become more aware of what they eat and what is the risk involved in eating whatever they are eating, then they'll be able to push the manufacturer, the retailer, the wholesaler to give them with more, quality products, and that way the industry will progress. Technological advancements will happen and ultimately we'll be in a progressive path. So food is a very very essential component to all of us. And what are the risks involved in consuming food? Okay, so this is also a subject which is very very relevant and related to food safety, which is growing, which is emerging as one of the most essential streams or disciplines of study or branches where people are making their career. So it's very very important. It's a subject that we all need to understand. So foodborne diseases, if we need to understand that, starting with a microbiological perspective, let's start with the most common, which is bacterial infection. Okay, I think we could skip that and go to straight to this image here. If you're able to see this image here, okay. Now this image is a very very important image. You should be able to understand this image in the right perspective. You can do that, then it should be of great help to us. Okay. Yeah. So if you are able to get a hold of this, not able to fix it up properly. Yeah. So yes, a little bit. Yeah. Foodborne diseases. Now, look at this. The image, this chart, which shows the hierarchy of the foodborne diseases and how it is classified. Let's get into that. Foodborne diseases, they are classified into poisonings and infections. This is a terminology that is generally used more in relevance to microbial foodborne diseases or biological foodborne diseases, if I can elaborate on that. So foodborne diseases classified into poisonings and infections. So let's go one after the other. Alright, so at one end we have poisonings and the other end we have infections. Poisoning straight away means the food is contaminated with a poisonous stuff, poisonous chemical. It could be a poisonous intoxicant that has been released by a microorganism, maybe, or naturally there could be a poisonous substance which is a plant product or an animal product. And when we consume these poison, the response from our body is going to be immediate, all right, and the effect, the health effect, what you see will be more immediate, more rapid, because it is straight chemical reaction. Okay, even this poisoning, now further we are classifying them into chemical poisons and intoxications. All right, when we say chemical poisoning, we are referring to something like maybe pesticides, like heavy use of pesticides in the agricultural farms, all right, or maybe heavy use of antibiotics in the poultry farms or in the dairy farms on the animals or the birds. It's going to increase the antibiotic load in the produce, the animal produce. The animal produce could be milk or red meat or whatever meat that is being consumed. So these are all simple chemical poisons. It could also be a cleaning agent. It could be a cleaning chemical that accidentally or purposefully is added onto the food consumables. It could be adulterants. Adulterants, when I say adulterants, they are purposefully added to the natural produce for umpteen number of reasons. For example, if we say milk, in milk, in order to keep the increase the shelf life of milk, people add preservatives to milk. Now these preservatives are pure chemicals, right? So if you consume these chemicals along with milk, that's adulteration, and these chemicals are going to cause poisoning. It's going to have a very bad effect on our health. Okay, so these are all basic chemical points. Besides that, you could also consider some of the additives. See, additives are those chemicals that are permitted by certain governments to be added into food. I could say preservatives, again coming back to preservatives, there are preservatives that the government is permitted to be added into different types of foods. There are different types of preservatives. There are chemicals, for example, there are synthetic dyes or colors that could be added into food to enhance the, you know, appearance or the appeal of the food. There could be emulsifiers, texture enhancers, taste enhancers. These, although are regulated by the government, they've been approved by the government for usage or for addition into food, but then over addition of them, there are stipulated limits within which these chemicals are permitted to be added, can be added. So if the addition of these chemicals, which you call them as additives, if it goes beyond those permissible limits, okay, they turn out to be deleterious, they turn out to be hazardous, so they can also be termed as chemical poisons. Alright, so poisoning, the first category is chemical poisoning. The second category that we talk about is intoxication. Now, intoxication is something different to poisoning, chemical poisoning. Chemical poisoning is a chemical substance which purposefully or without unknowingly, accidentally makes an entry into the food substance, and that is consumed along with the food substance. That causes the trouble, or that causes the harm that it does. Intoxication is a little different to that. Intoxication is consumption of poisons that have been produced in our food products. Okay, now food products, there are only two categories of food products if you consider them based on their source. Either they are plant-based or animal-based. Okay, either they are plant-based or animal-based. There is a very, very small fragment of microbial-based foods, which of course is a different subject. We will not be dealing with that in depth now here. But then, what we need to understand is, either in plant-based foods or in animal-based foods, okay, if by nature. Okay, these plant-based foods or animal-based foods are poisonous by nature. Okay, then by consuming these poisonous substances, obviously you are going to have health effects. Right. So, ancestrally, we know, and we've been taught over ages what to consume as food and what not to consume as food. All right. So you will not be picking up something called as a parthenium plant, and then grab those leaves and make curry out of it. No, that's not what you're going to do. That is something which is not supposed to be consumed. All right. So there are poisonous plants, there are poisonous animals that are not supposed to be consumed. For example, if you go to the eastern part of the world, people consume even reptiles. People also consume some of the amphibians. So there is no bar on what is to be consumed and what is not to be consumed. Even there, there are restrictions to what kind of animal products can be consumed. So if people consume, say, frogs, there are a type of variety of frogs that people don't consume, right? Because they turn out to be poisonous. They turn out to be extremely poisonous. So such poisons that are naturally a part of animal or a plant product are basically poisonous plant tissues and poisonous animal tissues that they are referring to here. Alright? So by consuming them, there is an instant, immediate reaction in your body, and that will be visible. That will be evident in maybe a few minutes or maybe maximum an hour or so, but the results or the implications will be evident in a very short period of time. Then next comes the microbial intoxication. Microbial intoxication, when I refer to here, is food microorganism that we've been discussing. Microorganisms are, we say they are ubiquitous. Some use the term cosmopolitan, some I would say they are omnipresent, because microorganisms are present everywhere in the creation. Besides, of course, now they are being searched for or looked for in the space as well, beyond the atmosphere as well. Microorganisms are being screened for, but then in the earth, okay, there is hardly any place where you don't find microorganisms. You may not get microorganisms in places where in things where they have been objectively kept free of microorganisms. Okay, so that is objectively created human creation where microorganisms have been kept away. Aseptic conditions have been maintained. So they are all different conditions. But then microorganisms or those living species, they are one of our oldest ancestors that are there almost in every aspects of our life that we see. It may be in the mouth that I'm handling right now, it may be in the pen that I'm holding right now, in my laptop, in my body, in my hair, in my mouth, in my intestinal tract, in the table that I'm feeding, this chair that I'm sitting. So it's there everywhere. And these microorganisms, they're also a part of our food. So our food naturally has a normal flora. When I say normal flora, a normally existing microbial load is always present in the food that we consume. Now the question is, the microbial load that is present in the food, they can be the ones that are either spoilage causing or the ones that are beneficial or the ones that are harmful to our body. The ones that we call as a pathogenic organisms, right? So disease causing microorganisms, they could be present. So all the three variety of microorganisms could be present in the food. Now among these, when we narrow down to the microorganisms that are pathogenic, that are disease causing, among the disease causing microorganisms, there is one variety of microorganisms, the way they cause the illness, okay, human illness, is by releasing toxins. Toxins are what? When I say toxins, say almost all toxins are proteins. Okay, they release these proteins into the food that they inhabit. Okay, in the food that they inhabit, and when you consume this food along with those toxins released by the microorganism, then it shows an effect on your body. So that is basically is what is called as microbial intoxication. When I say intoxication, the toxin goes into your body. It's not the microorganism that causes the disturbance. It is the toxin that you take inside along with the food that has been released by the microorganism that causes the effect. Alright, so these microbial toxins can be further categorized into three: algal toxins, mycotoxins, and bacterial toxins. Algal toxins, mycotoxins, and bacterial toxins. When I say algal toxins, algae, toxins released by algae. Okay, there are some of the algae, of course, again, going back to the Eastern world, especially, for example, in Japan, and the countries, neighboring countries, consuming seaweeds, that is algae, is very common. In fact, in India also, we have started consuming seaweeds in the name of spirulina. We started consuming algae. Okay, so spirulina is a cyanobacterium. Some of them still classify them as algae, so we consume them. So if these algae release toxins, and if they are consumed along with food, okay, that can cause damage. So that is what here is referred to as algal toxins. That is what here is referred to as algal toxin. When I say mycotoxins, okay, mycotoxins here refers to toxins released by fungi. Myco here refers to fungi. Mycology, the study of fungi. Okay, so toxins released by fungi are basically called as mycotoxins. So in our food, there could be fungal contamination as well. So if fungal contamination is there, and these fungi release toxins into the food, and that food is consumed by us, that is going to have serious health effects, and that is going to be very immediate. Okay, you can see those effects happening in our body very fast. Okay, for example, there is something called as aflatoxin that we'll be discussing very soon in our lecture. So aflatoxin is a very, very common fungal toxin, mycotoxin, that is released by the species Aspergillus flavus. Mostly afla is a term that is derived from Aspergillus flavus, afla. Okay, so they are mycotoxins, fungal toxins. Then comes something called as the bacterial toxin. This is the most commonly discussed toxin, bacterial toxin. So bacteria, we know they may be present in food. In fact, in most cases they are present in food. Bacteria also, the ones that are spoilage causing, the ones that are beneficial for us, and the ones that are pathogenic, that are disease causing. So all three variety of microbial bacteria can be present in food. Among them, there are microorganisms, there are bacteria that specifically produce toxins, and these toxins are released into the medium. When I say the medium, they are released into the food. And when these toxins are consumed along with the food, that causes intoxication. That is what we are referring to here. Alright, intoxication. Bacterial intoxication. Now, bacterial intoxication, further, they are classified based on the site of action where they show the effect, where they act in our body. So, enterotoxin, they are toxins that show, that causes damage or that causes disturbance in our intestinal tract, the gastrointestinal tract. That's what here is referred to as the enterobe. Alright, when you say enterobe, it refers to the gastrointestinal tract. So enterotoxins. Okay, so most cases these enterotoxins definitely will cause symptoms like diarrhea, dysentery, headache, vomiting, and so on, nausea, and so on. Okay, so they are toxins that are bacterial toxins are classified based on the site of action. So enterotoxin is one. The next is neurotoxins. Obviously, from the very name you can understand, they are toxins that has effect on the neural system, on the neurons, on the nervous system of our body, and that is also immediate. Alright, there could be example, many which we'll be discussing now. I don't want to take those names right now. Let's keep that bit of suspense a little bit, so that we enjoy the subject more. So neurotoxins, okay. After neurotoxins, there are toxins that interfere with carbohydrate metabolism. Okay, so in your food, carbohydrate is one of the major chunk which is used as a source of carbon, which is used as a ready source of energy, and which is actually the form of what do you call nutrient that all foods are brought into, and even if you consider if you consume a complex food, the complex food is broken down, converted into glucose, and then they're digested further. So that's how our body functions. So the metabolism of carbohydrate in our body is disturbed, and that is caused by a toxin that is basically released by the bacterial species that may have contaminated your food. Alright, so this is how poisonings are classified. Alright, now let's go into the next aspect, that is basically infections. We discussed about poisonings. This is the other aspect is infections. Infection, let us turn the medical, let us understand the medical terminology of the term infection. When I say infection, infection means when a microorganism makes an entry into our body. It's mere entry of the contaminating microorganism into our body. So if the entry is through food, then that is food infection, foodborne infection. If the entry of a microorganism is through food, that is foodborne infection. Alright, now infection, that means when a microorganism, a bacterial organism, a fungi makes an entry into our body, what happens next? So it will initially try to fight against our host immune system, our immune system, and if by any chance it wins over the immune system, it survives the immune system in your body, then it is going to show, it is going to multiply, it is going to rapidly grow inside your body, making use of the nutrients and the environment available inside your body. These microorganisms, infective microorganisms, grow and multiply, and as a result they cause the damage that they do. Alright, so infection can be brought down to two here that is discussed: enterotoxigenic and invasive. When I say enterotoxigenic, the microorganism infects, it goes inside, alright, and it releases toxin inside our body. In this case here, we are referring to the, when I say intoxication, we are referring to consumption of the toxin released by the microorganism in the food. So the toxin is consumed along with the food. But in this case here, when I am referring to enterotoxigenicity, I am referring to the bacterial infection happening, that the bacteria itself is going inside your body. The microorganism going inside your body, it's making an entry. After it makes an entry, it grows inside our body. Okay. And as it grows inside our body, they start releasing toxins. And that is what is called as enterotoxigenicity. And when these toxins are there inside your intestinal tract, and the toxins are released in your intestinal tract or show effect in your intestinal tract, that is what is referred to as enterotoxigenicity. The next category is invasive. Being invasive, invasive is a lot different, where the microorganism not only makes an entry into your body, but it also makes an entry into your tissues and multiplies in those tissues. And as they multiply inside the tissue, they cause a lot of damage to the tissue. It's not about release of toxin, it's about consumption of the nutrients that are basically our body cells or the tissues that are derived from our body cells and tissues. So they cause a lot of damage to the tissues and the cells, and that is what is called as being invasive. Okay, now enterotoxigenicity can be as a result of sporulation, growth and lysis. Sporulation, that is inside your body the microorganisms turn into spores, okay, that is sporulation, and inside your body they cause growth happens and they lyse the cells around, okay, so that is also happening. So that is what is referred to here under enterotoxigenicity. Right, then let's go to the, alright, so when we come to invasive, so invasiveness, that is the microorganism after making an entry into our body, they try to make entry into the tissues. Alright, so the type of tissue they generally make entry into, because they are foodborne, remember, they are foodborne. Alright, so they don't have access to lungs, they don't have access to kidney, they don't have access to maybe heart, no, they don't have access to any of these. They don't have access to our arms, our legs, no, they have access to the intestinal mucosa. Definitely yes. Okay, that's how the food flows through in our body. So intestinal mucosa, they start getting invading our intestinal mucosa. Alright, intestinal mucosa is the inner layer of our intestinal tract, where the mucous membrane is there. There are many other objects, something like villi, they are all small hair-like structures in our body, in our intestine, which is actually responsible for the bolus movement. Alright, so they actually invade the intestinal mucosa. Then you have systemic infection is caused. Systemic infection is the invasiveness from one part of the body, they move from one part of the body to other parts of the body. Alright, when that happens, so the infection is not refrained to your intestinal tract, but it is moved to other parts of the body. Now that you say is growing systemic. Alright, then invasiveness can also cause disturbance to muscles and to liver. That is movement of these organisms from one part to the other part. So this broadly gives you what foodborne diseases are. You need to understand this classification clearly. Right. Now let's get to one of the most commonly discussed foodborne diseases, which is the bacterial foodborne disease. Yeah, so we were talking about bacterial foodborne diseases. Now, besides bacterial foodborne diseases, you know, there are fungal bacterial foodborne diseases, then fungal foodborne diseases, or mostly it is, if it is fungal, it is intoxication. Fungi in most cases do not make entry along the food into our body system and cause invasive or, you know, infection. That normally doesn't happen. Mostly in cases of fungi, it is intoxication, that is fungal toxins released into the medium. So we'll be talking about that. And then we have protozoal diseases caused by protozoans, for example entamoeba. Okay, it causes amoebiasis. So we'll be talking about infections, protozoal infections that are through food. And then lastly, not the least, most important of all, helminth infections through food. Helminths, when I refer to, they are worms that are consumed along with the food, and then they make an entry into your body and they grow as bigger worms inside your body system. So we'll be talking of each of this. Now let us start with foodborne diseases, that is bacterial foodborne diseases. Now, as we discussed earlier, so we have these, the classification here, the categorization remains, that is intoxication and infection. Intoxication and infection. We've already discussed what intoxication means, we've already discussed what infection means, but let me reiterate. Intoxication is when the toxin is released by the bacterium into the food. The bacterial population grows in numbers, and as they grow in number, alright, after they reach a particular population density, what they do? They release the toxin into the medium. The medium that they live is food. So they release the toxin into the medium. So when you consume these toxins along with the food, we are not talking of consuming the bacteria along with the food. We are talking of consuming the toxin along with the food. When these toxins are consumed along with the food, that is called as intoxication. Alright, and because we are consuming the toxin, there is no growth element happening in our body. These are basically proteins. All toxins are protein. I must tell you, snake poison is also a protein. You should know this. Alright, now when you consume these toxins go into our body, alright, and have an immediate effect. So the incubation time, that is the response time, from the time you consume the toxin along with the food to the time the symptoms appear in our body, okay, is very short in terms of intoxication. All right. So intoxication, we generally talk of two main intoxicants, that is bacterial intoxicants in our body. One is staphylococcal intoxication. One is the staphylococcal intoxication, and the other is toxins produced by Clostridium botulinum. Okay. Now, mind you, they both are very important. I will explain with examples. Staphylococcal intoxication. Staphylococcus aureus. All right. Now, Staphylococcus aureus is a very, very common bacterium that is present almost in all types of food. And the infection or contamination of food of Staphylococcus aureus generally happens because of pure personal hygiene related issues. Because in our body, in our skin, in our hair, Staphylococcus aureus is a very, very common contaminant. It's a normal flora, I would say. It's a part of our body, skin, our hair, our moustache, our hands. They are very common in our body. Now, if we do not maintain hygiene standards, we are going to be giving Staphylococcus aureus to the food. Right? And if the food is not cooked, if you are going to be consuming semi-processed food, alright, or raw food, you can expect a very heavy load of Staphylococcus aureus. Now, Staphylococcus aureus releases enterotoxin. We have already discussed enterotoxin here. So, enterotoxins are those toxins that have an effect in our intestinal tract, in our gastrointestinal system. Alright, the site of action is the intestine. Alright, so your nutrient absorption, your bowel movement, everything is going to change. You're going to have diarrhea, you will have vomiting, you will have loose motions, you will have nausea, you will have headache, you may have fever. So these are all the symptoms that show up. Now, one thing that we need to understand, when does Staphylococcus aureus release these toxins into the food? It's not that when the population of Staphylococcus aureus in the food, say, is in about hundreds, thousands, no. If they are in hundreds, if they are in thousands, yes, it's an indicator that the personal hygiene standards have dropped. But then, enterotoxin by Staphylococcus aureus is released when the population density of Staphylococcus aureus in the food is more than a million per gram. That is, when the cell concentration, when the population density of Staphylococcus aureus alone reaches more than a million per gram, it is the condition when the enterotoxin is released by Staphylococcus aureus. Staphylococcus aureus presence in food is always indicative of hygiene. Alright? And if their population density is very high in food, mind you, the food may have caused already damage to the one who has consumed it. Alright? So, the most risky food, when you talk of Staphylococcus intoxication, that you should be very, very wary of consuming, are food items like sandwiches, which are, I would say, raw or semi-processed. You won't call them as processed at all. There is no heat treatment involved, hardly any heat treatment involved. Alright? So these are items which also involve a lot of handling. Okay, lot of processing, lot of human handling is involved. And when there are food items, there are a lot of food handling and which does not undergo heat treatment, mind you, you'll have to be very careful about that food. Alright? Besides food handling, it is also that in the making of a sandwich, okay, there is a lot of contact surface that gets in. There are a lot of surfaces that get in contact with the food. Maybe a cucumber, a tomato, or whatever the filling that you want to have inside. There are a lot of contacts that are happening of the food with different surfaces. And these surfaces can carry forward Staphylococcus aureus to the food. Okay, so you need to remember this. So items like semi-processed item, one big item that is a very risky item as far as Staphylococcus aureus is concerned, that is pastries. Pastries and cakes where there is a lot of cream involved. Cream is a very ideal medium for microbial contamination and growth. It's not discontamination and growth. And cream, if you actually watch the process, the way pastries are made, the way the cakes are made, the creamy layers are laid, there's a lot of human handling, there's a lot of contact happening there. Alright, so Staphylococcus aureus is bound to contaminate this food, these type of food, and if they are contaminated, mind you, and if they are not kept in the right conditions, they are not stored properly, refrigerated properly, you are in for it. Alright, so Staphylococcus intoxication is very common. The next that we commonly discuss is botulism. Now this you need to know. Alright, botulism, I'll tell you something about botulism. The botulinum toxin, the magnitude of the risk of consuming botulinum toxinum is such, it is believed that botulinum toxin is more dreadful than snake poison, snake venom. However, they believe, it is also believed, if you are able to, if you have managed to get one teaspoonful of botulinum toxin, of course that's a, it's an imaginary situation, but if we can have 1 teaspoon of botulinum toxin, and that 1 teaspoon of botulinum toxin is enough to wipe out the entire human population in the face of Earth. That is the amount of seriousness that is involved when we talk of botulinum toxin. However, botulinum toxin today, in the name of Botox, is being used as a treatment for shedding fat in cosmetic surgeries. So Botox toxin is being used in the most limited quantities possible. It is used for fat shedding and in cosmetic surgeries. Botox toxin is being used. Now, where and how does botulinum toxin come to be? Botulinum, the name itself is, you can make out, is derived from something related to bottles, you know. So canned food is one of the biggest source and risk of carrying botulinum toxin. Why? Botulinum toxin is released by an organism called Clostridium botulinum. It is released by an organism called Clostridium botulinum. It's a bacterial species. Now, Clostridium botulinum is an anaerobic bacteria. When I say anaerobic bacteria, these are microorganisms, they are bacteria that can survive only in the absence of oxygen. Very limited trace amounts of oxygen will kill these organisms. So they are opposite to the way we are. Okay, they cannot survive in the presence of oxygen. So that's why we call them as anaerobic organism. So in a canned food, what happens in a canned food? Once you can them, and assume that during the process of canning, aseptic conditions are not maintained. When I say aseptic conditions, you ensure that during packaging or processing, the environment is microbe-free and contamination does not happen in the food. But due to unavoidable conditions or due to poor monitoring, contamination, assume that contamination does happen in a type of food and that food is canned. After canning is done, generally people use a process called retorting. Retorting is, these canned food are heated after they are canned. They undergo heat treatment after they are canned. And if the retorting process does not effectively kill the contaminating microorganisms, and assume the contaminating microorganism has both aerobic microorganism and spores of Clostridium botulinum. Mind you, spores of Clostridium botulinum can survive aerobic conditions. Not the vegetative forms, but spores can survive. What happens? The aerobic microorganisms that have contaminated the food and not been killed by any heat treatment, after canning is done, during storage, these microorganisms, they will multiply. And because canning means sealing, there is no exchange of gas. what happens? These microorganisms utilize all the available gases, oxygen inside the can, and once they have consumed the entire oxygen available in the can, now the condition has turned anaerobic. There is no oxygen available inside the medium. Now the aerobic microorganism, they will gradually decline in population. Their population will gradually decline because there is no oxygen available. That is a stage where, if in that food anaerobic spores of Clostridium botulinum have contaminated, these spores will germinate, they will get back to their vegetative form, and as they get back to their vegetative form in the anaerobic condition, they will grow, multiply, and as they multiply, they will release the neurotoxin. So botulinum toxin is basically a neurotoxin that has effect in our neurons, and that is why it's very, very dreaded. How, what kind of damage it does, we will talk about it later. But now these two are classified under intoxication. Alright. Okay. So last 10 minutes, let me see if we can finish off the infection part as well. That is intoxication where we are consuming the toxin released by the microorganism into the food, and the toxin causes the damage that it does. The infection is a little different. Infection is the bacteria or the bacterium that causes the disease is present in the food in whatever quantity, and we consume the food along with the bacterial population that makes an entry into our body. Now that is infection. When microorganisms make an entry into the body, that's called as infection. Alright? So we are mainly talking of here about 6 to 7 of these organisms that are basically making an entry and the type of diseases that are caused. Alright? So Salmonella, the species of Salmonella is one of the most common and most discussed when it comes to food. Species of Salmonella causes something called as typhoid, if you heard of that. Right? Typhoid is a very, very common organ, common disease. So infection by Salmonella species can cause typhoid, paratyphoid. Okay, that's number one. Clostridium perfringens, Salmonella, let me just give an example of the type of food that they normally are present in. Poultry-based food, a simple example. Eggs, poultry, chicken, alright, they're very common in poultry-based food, alright. In milk as well, they're very common. Then comes Clostridium perfringens, like we discussed of Clostridium botulinum here. Similarly, Clostridium perfringens, they are into the same genus and they are also anaerobic. They are also anaerobic. Right? So, if these organisms make an entry into our digestive system, in the digestive system, they can release toxins that can cause damage to the intestinal tract. But they will have to give the suitable environment, that is the anaerobic environment, for them to release the toxin. Alright? The next is Bacillus cereus. Alright? Bacillus cereus. This is an organism that is normally present in items that are really heat treated. I would say lentils, cereals, pulses, I might say. If you cook rice, alright, after cooking, generally pressure cooking is like sterilization, alright. You are getting food devoid of all the microorganisms present, you're killing all of them. But then, if the adequate temperature is not attained. That is 121 degree Celsius is not attained, and it is not kept at 15. It is not kept for 15 minutes. Then it is likely that organisms like Bacillus cereus survive the temperature. In general, the genus Bacillus are the ones that are extremely heat tolerant. They're thermophilic to an extent. And the other ones, they normally survive high temperature. And because they survive high temperature, they are the common contaminants of heat treated food. And if they are present in food and if they are consumed along with the food, alright, they can release enterotoxin in our intestinal tract. So that is the third example. Then you have E. coli, the most researched microorganism in the history of science. E. coli, enteropathogenic E. coli, mind you, all forms of E. coli, there are different strains of E. coli, all different types of E. coli, all E. coli do not cause disease. Some of the types of E. coli, they are also normal, you know, the normal flora of our body, of our intestine, so they need not necessarily cause infection. But EPEC, enteropathogenic E. coli, is a type of E. coli that can cause the infection, that can lead to disease from infection. Okay, and they are invasive, mind you, they are invasive. Alright, we have discussed what invasive is earlier. Besides these, there are also diseases that is caused, that is basically called as Yersiniosis. Yersiniosis is caused by the genus Yersinia. Alright, Shigellosis is caused by the genus Shigella, Shigella dysenteriae, Shigella flexneri, different types of species within Shigella. Then there is something called as Vibrio hemolyticus. They are the ones that are more associated with seafoods because they are extremely salt tolerant, halophilic organism. They can withstand high salt concentration. That's why they are more common in seafoods. So they are basically examples of infection, that is bacteria making an entry into our body and causing damage after their multiplication or replication inside our body system. So I will end with it here for this lecture. We will continue with these infecting microorganisms, the type of food, the kind of symptoms that they cause and all of that in the following lecture. Thanks for today. Thank you so much.